lovelies, and welcome once again to the Queen's Curry Kitchen, where we are actually on the final step of frying these potato cutlets. I have oil in the pan, which is about 3/4 of the height of this patty, nice and hot. We will see the moment of truth, and we will know whether we have made the patty right or not. And these have just rested in the fridge for about 15 to 20 minutes. So in they go. Once you put it in, just keep your heat from medium to low. And try not to flip them too many times. You're trying to get a good color on it. But don't flip them around too much. Right? So the potatoes are fully cooked. You just have to give it a good color. So in go about 5. So I have a total of 10. I think I'm going to do 4 and not overcrowd the pan. Also remember, when you add something cold to your hot oil, it actually brings down the temperature of the oil. So just honor that and be with it to see what it's going to look like. I'm going to try not to flip it too many times. Just trying to find the right ladle to flip this with. Sometimes you may need 2 ladles instead of 1, and that's fine too. If you have a cast iron skillet, you can very well do this in there. Another tip: when you're putting things in a pan to fry, always follow a certain direction so that when you're flipping it, you know which one you put in first. So that's a tip that I learned when I worked in commercial kitchens. At home, I never really paid attention to that. Nor did my mom teach me that as a tip or a trick, right? So if you start from here, then go clockwise. If you go counterclockwise, which means even when you're flipping them, you're going to go this way. I'm able to see that right underneath it, there's a little bit of a... I don't know if you can see it really close. Hold on. There's a little bit of a golden crust developing. I don't know if you can see it. So I'm going to let that do its thing. And I'm going to put on my glasses and say a quick hello to all the lovely people that are joining me right now, very patiently, who have watched all 3 sections and segments of this. Sushma ji, welcome again to Frying the Aloo Tikkis. Tim, thank you so much for your continued support and love. I really appreciate it. Sarla, of course, my dear friend, tuning in from Long Island. So thank you all. This is the third and final step of actually frying the aloo tikkis or the potato cutlets. If you don't like to fry anything, you can always bake it at 300 for about 15 to 20 minutes and it will give you good results. You can also air fry it. Unfortunately, I don't have the settings for an air fryer that I can tell you, but if you air fried any kind of cutlets or patties and you want to drop that temperature or setting in the comments below, that would be greatly helpful to our other viewers who are going to actually be air frying their potato cutlets. So you see this? It's really perfectly golden. This is not the magic of television or editing. This is real life, real food that involves real skill. But that's my goal as a chef, as an instructor, as somebody who's trying to preserve the food heritage of the culture that I come from. I try to stay as authentic to the cooking methods as possible, and I try to explore the science behind why something works and why it doesn't, and that's the only time when I actually tell you it's to be done a certain way. So any kind of patties or burgers that you're making, definitely chill them in the fridge 15 to 20 minutes. It makes a huge difference to the quality of the outcome. For all my Indian viewers who are tuning in right now, I really would like to know, do you miss eating aloo tikki in India, right? Actually, you know what, now that you're here, let me actually show you the classic pairings that go with it. And I've created some condiments which I will be serving alongside this. Everything is homemade. So one thing that goes with the aloo tikki is even 2 hands are not enough sometimes, right? Let me open this. So one classic pairing that always goes with aloo tikki is the chana masala, which is chickpeas, but I have not made those. I've made this green cilantro chutney. This is a classic pairing that gets drizzled on top of the potato cutlet. Also remember that the potatoes actually themselves are very lightly salted. We don't salt them because as soon as you put salt, then moisture starts to get into the potatoes and then it doesn't make for a crisp sticky. So don't salt your potatoes too much if you're making anything that is potato based that you intend to fry. Okay, I'm gonna get in there and see. So I started with this one, so that's the same order in which I will flip it. I have not touched my flame. It's a little bit lower than medium. I'm gonna just, this is the second flip I'm gonna give it. It's not quite as brown as I would like it to be, so I'll just leave it in there. And sometimes when you mess with it too much, then it tends to break and all the beautiful crust ends up staying in the pan. So that's not what we're going for. Okay, so I'm just going to leave it in there. I cranked up the heat just a little bit. This is a date jaggery and dry ginger powder chutney, which is sweet, salty. It has roasted cumin. So that's another accompaniment that gets drizzled on top of the aloo tikki. And then one other thing which I like to add, which is not necessarily served, is this. So I do like a pickled carrot and onions that I slivered and soaked in vinegar. So these are nice and crunchy, but they're also beautiful in their texture, tart and salty. So these are the three pairings that I actually serve with my potato cutlet. I'm gonna get in there and see if it's time to flip it one more time. Sushma G is asking if she can swing by and come and eat it. Yes, please come. You're very welcome to come anytime to my house to enjoy whatever you see that I'm cooking. Everybody's welcome. I wish this lockdown and this whole social distancing thing wasn't so crazily affecting everybody's lives, so we could actually meet more often in person. But you know what? The fact that you all come here and hang out with me in my kitchen and support my endeavors makes it very special for me. I acknowledge, appreciate, and honor each and every one of you because you are the reason that I keep going. So as you can see, this particular one is taking the longest to get going. And I think the reason might be that my flame is a little bit uneven. So this one is almost done. I'm going to take that off. This is going to need more time on this side. So it's just, you know, very carefully and with a very light hand, you must do this. Hi, I just wanted to quickly welcome Deva Bia, who's tuning in. Miss Ali is watching. Welcome, welcome to the Queen's Curry Kitchen. I'm going to now start taking these off the pan. And ideally, you want to drain it on a paper towel. If you're old school and you have grandmothers or grandfathers, they really don't believe in draining the oil off of anything. So they'll probably scream at you, oh my God, you took out the best part. Yeah. So traditionally, aloo tikkis are actually fried in ghee. And I tell you, the combination of ghee with potatoes, oh my God, the carbs on carbs, it's really a slice of heaven. But I've used light olive oil. But typically, traditionally, what is actually used is ghee. Okay? So this is how we do it. Here's my crispy, crunchy potato aloo tikki. I don't know if you can see it. There's too much glare, I think. Yeah, so this is it. And maybe I'll get a fork and scrape the top so you can actually hear the sound at the front. I need to spoon it for a second. But you know what they say, the proof is in the pudding. So let me actually get these guys off before they decide to burn on me. Very carefully, no rush. And this is one exclusive appetizer that's like completely handmade. It's literally a labor of love. So samosas and aloo tikki are something that are really underestimated because they are sold at a low price point, but there is so much labor intensive work that goes into putting it together that it's often overlooked. This is the last one from the first batch that's coming off right now. There you go. So the part that is actually close to the pan, when you remove it from the hot oil, put that side up instead of down so that it doesn't start sweating and forming droplets of moisture to kill the crispness. Okay, so the five right now, maybe I'll leave it at that. I'll do that one in the end. Now the moment of truth, let me just take this one and scrape it right in front of the camera so you can probably hear it. I might turn off my... So here. You hear how crisp it is? Yeah, and it's super soft on the inside and it's absolutely crisp. The more it cools actually, the more crisp it becomes. So that's what, it's perfectly cooked. It's super duper hot. You can see it's perfectly cooked and it did not fall apart, which is actually the true test of aloo tikki done right. So if anybody's craving this, wants to make it at home, wants to learn how to do it, definitely enroll for a class. QueensCurryKitchen.com. If you wanna get my next book, stay tuned because it is going to be released very soon. And it's an Indian twist on all international recipes. So let me take a good look at this. So I have some fenugreek leaves that I'm sauteing here in the other pan. I think I'm gonna have to put some water in here. Sorry for the distraction, but I really need to look into this so that it's not gonna burn on me. And this is from frozen methi, which is actually from India. So I like the frozen one because you don't have to clean the dirt and the grime from off of it. So I like that. Alright, so this is going to simmer for a bit. Alright, so with that I come to the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed the three parts and it did not cause you too much anxiety for the gratification. I hope you will give this a try. Oh, thank you, Tim. I appreciate your encouragement. I'm trying to finish it as fast as I can. It will be a digital book, so you'll be able to download it and take it anywhere on the go. And you can also print it from wherever you want to print it. But it is in the works. So there's actually two of them. One is just based on spices for omnivorous families. So there's flexitarian recipes. And the other one is actually based on international recipes that have been Indianized. So yes, I will continue to finish this. But again, thank you so much for joining me today. I really appreciate each and every one of you. I hope that you will see me again in my kitchen real soon, one of these days. And you know, keep being blissful, be flavorful. Thank you for the love and support. Have a great weekend. And don't forget to check out QueensCurryKitchen.com. Yes, they will be all vegan recipes. Tim, there's a lot of vegan and vegetarian recipes, and if it's a vegetarian recipes, I will put in the vegan alternative. So yes, it's primarily vegan. The flexitarian book has for five top spices that are most common in the world. There's going to be one vegan recipe, one plant-based recipe, and one meat recipe. One plant-based and one meat. So if we're doing cumin, then there's like a cumin plant-based recipe, and then there's a cumin with something else. So that's pretty much how the book is laid out. So it's really good for omni families, for flexitarian people who are not 100% plant-based, but you know, we're all somewhere in that journey. So that's a good starting point for them. Okay, so I'm going to continue with romancing these little aloo tikkis and showing them all the love. But I hope you will give this a try. If you do try it and you have any questions, or if it turns out to be super duper wow, just like all of you, then definitely tag me. My Instagram handle is at queenscurrykitchen.com, and also of course you know Facebook is Queen's Curry Kitchen. And if you follow and like my page, you will get notifications of every time that I'm live on Facebook, so that you won't miss any of the fantastic recipes and all the fun that we have, right? What about that? Alright, so with that I'm gonna say goodbye. I hope you have a great weekend. Namaste, and thank you for joining me. Sushma ji, thank you so much. You're very welcome for thanks. And you know what, I have used your peppers today in one of my dishes, I just hope that it's not too spicy, but I'm using it slowly and steadily. So thanks again for sharing the bounties from your garden. I appreciate each and every one of you. I will see you very soon in the next one. Have a wonderful weekend. Namaste and God bless you all.